गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, थिंक ब्रेनस्टॉर्म शेयर, दिस इज द प्राउड स्लोगन ऑफ टीबीएस और द बीस्पोक शो. ऑन द बीस्पोक शो वी इनवाइट एक्सपर्ट्स ऑन वेरियस कॉन्टेम्पररी टॉपिक्स टू शेयर इनसाइट्स फ्रॉम देयर वैल्यूएबल एक्सपीरियंसेस एंड वी कॉल इट टीबीएस कॉर्पोरेट. वी ऑल्सो इन्वाइट स्टूडेंट्स एंड एनकरेज देम टू स्पीक अप on topics that are relevant to them and that impact them and revolve around them, and we call it TBS Junior. Why the name the Bespoke Show? Well, as the name Bespoke suggests, this show is candid, uncensored, and customized. On this note, I would like to invite all the panelists on this evening for another exciting edition of the Bespoke Show Corporate. I'd also like to extend a warm welcome to all the audience watching us today. The topic that we have selected for today could not have been more appropriate and relevant. It's a topic that impacts every Indian, every parent, every school, every teacher, every corporate, and almost every player in the education ecosystem, including those that are responsible for the mental well-being of students. So the topic is Hopes, Aspirations, and Fears, the National Education Policy 2020. And so the panel has been designed to cover every voice that matters on this topic today. What's also interesting is that the gender parity could not have been better achieved, right? We are perfectly balanced. So welcome you all to the show. And before we go deep into the topic, maybe the audience would like to hear from each of you in your own voice about what exactly your organization does very briefly. Maybe I can start with Dr. Jyoti.
Namaste everyone. So I am proud to say that I am the founder principal of the Shriram Universal School, which is located in Financial District, Hyderabad. This is a partner school of Shri Educare Limited. It is like sister school of Shriram College of Commerce from Delhi. That is a legacy of Manju Bharat, Padma Shri Manju Bharat Ram. Yes, the core values of our school are integrity, pursuit of excellence, pride in one's culture, and sensitivity. So with the philosophy of grounding the Indian values and traditions in the children, with the pursuit of excellence to become a global citizen, the school has been launched in 2017. So we basically believe in bettering the best. So we don't encourage competition with others first. It is only bettering the best. Then you compete with the world. Then the focus is nurturing creativity and igniting curiosity. So they appear as jargons. They are aligned with the curriculum at every step. Thank you so much.
Welcome, Dr. Jyoti Reddy. That was Jyoti Reddy, founder principal of the Shriram Universal School. Mr. Manas, over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Asha, and good evening, everyone. Indeed, a privilege to be with all of you and meeting some old colleagues like Sid and Jyoti ma'am. So on Radcliffe's more than 12 years of existence, we believe in giving quality education at an affordable price. And that itself is a quest, which is more like a journey rather than a destination. We have schools all over India, predominantly in Mumbai. We have 4 schools in Mumbai and almost one school in every top cities in India, like Pune, Hyderabad, Bangalore, Cochin. And in north, we have 2 schools in Punjab, Bathinda and Patiala, and then Jaipur and Bhopal. And just to summarize, I think the prime objective of any education institution is to ensure that you cater to a particular segment and, cater well, provide the right level of service. And that's what Radcliffe believes in. we believe through these set of 12 schools and hoping to look at much bigger number in the future, we believe to cater to this segment and ensure that we bridge the gap of quality education and price as much as possible. So that's Radcliffe in a nutshell, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Manas. That was Mr. Manas Singh, CEO Radcliffe Group of Schools. Over to you, Mr. Shantanu.
Thank you, Asha ma'am. Good evening, everybody. It's really a pleasure to be here. I'm Shantanu, and I'm working with a private organization. But today here, I am in the capacity of a parent. My son, he is a student of Trio World School in Bangalore. And as you know, that parents nowadays within the COVID times are totally confused that right now with COVID times itself, what's happening, it's going to be online or offline or both, or plus this new education policy. So yeah, I think it will be really a good opportunity to hear from the experts. And I'm looking forward to a very fruitful discussion today. Thank you.
Thank you, Shantanu. So that was Mr. Shantanu Shirish, representing a parent's voice from the Trio World School. Over to you, Mr. Navneet.
Hello, everyone. I am Navneet, and I am currently a fourth year undergraduate student of IIT Bombay. So I am currently studying electrical engineering, and I was part of the entrepreneurship of IIT Bombay. So I'm really glad to be in this panel session among all the people as well as the CEOs of different groups as well as the principals of the board. Thank you for that.
Thank you, Navneet. That was Navneet Prabhat representing the student voice today on the panel. He is from IIT Bombay. Can we move over to you, Mridula?
Hi, hi everybody. I'm Mridula. I'm the director of Credo. So Credo is an organization. Credo Enterprises is an organization that's spent about 3 decades in early education. Credo as a solution enables preschools to set up their own preschools, and we've been working in the space of activity-based learning in a sense in various capacities. Some as product suppliers, some as service providers. Aim is to ensure that activity-based learning becomes the foundation for every child. Glad to see NEP has a lot to say on that, so I'm sure we'll have an exciting discussion on that going forward. And it's great to see the diversity of this panel, and I hope to hear some very interesting perspectives from the other side.
Thank you, Mridula. That was Mridula Sridhar, founder director from the Credo Early Childhood Education. Vasundhara, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. I'm very excited to be here. I am Vasundhara Isnair. I am a senior research fellow under the University Grants Commission, as well as a mental health clinician at NIMHANS, which stands for National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences. I'm currently also doing my PhD. As I said, I'm a senior research fellow, so which is in the area of brain infections. Whilst I also see as a clinician my neurological patients, which come in a wide range from child to geriatric population. So that's about me. I'm a Global Goodwill Ambassador as well as an Erasmus exchange student. So I'm very happy to be here, and I hope we have an enlightening session today. Thank you.
Thank you, Vasundhara. So that was Ms. Vasundhara Nair, Senior Research Fellow from NIMHANS. So welcome once again to all of you, and a pleasure to hand over the mic to Sid to set off the discussions.
Thank you. Thank you, Asha, and welcome to all the panelists. I hope I'm audible. So discussing, or rather criticizing, shall I say, the Indian education system seems to be a favorite conversation in all living rooms, or maybe even on social media such as LinkedIn and chats among the successful elite of India. I have come across several comparisons being made even with the education system of Finland, Australia, and so on. Just to put things in perspective, Finland is half the size of Bangalore in terms of population, and Australia could be almost similar to Punjab in terms of population. I acknowledge that there are problems in the education system, but definitely we have made good progress as well. The new education policy was much awaited, and everyone desperately wanted it. We wanted a change. We wanted to be on par with the US and so on. But there are hopes, there are fears, and that is what we are here today to hear out diverse perspectives from each one of you. So we will begin with some of the points that we had in mind that we collected from feedback from various people, and we thought we should put it in front of this panel so that we can collect your views on this. So the first point that we have today for discussion is about the medium of instruction as per the new education policy, which recommends that you teach or you learn in your mother tongue or the regional language. So Karnataka, you have Kannada and you learn in Kannada till 7th standard or 8th standard, or Tamil Nadu, you learn in Tamil and so on. So from a learning perspective, how does this impact? Is it beneficial, non-beneficial? And as children grow up, what is the competitive advantage? Are they going to lose out, of not knowing English, or how is it? So I would like to hear the learning part first from Vasundhara on how does it impact the learning, the speed of learning or long-term impact? And then maybe others can also chip in terms of competitive advantage when they grow up.
Okay, thank you for the question. Well, thank you. You can hear me? Yeah. So from a learning perspective, it's like this. It can become easier for them, as content and ideas will be straight away delivered and be taught in a language that they're already, very much comfortable with. That could be something that we can hold as a perspective. But the question being that, will they lose the advantage? Well, the possibility is there for that as well. We've seen in the European structure where English is brought in at a much later stage, we've seen students struggling, finding it extremely difficult, or even for that matter, the students who have studied, in our own culture, in our own country, who have studied in their own mother tongue for a very long period of time and had then had to suddenly shift off to English, took time, and it affected their confidence, potential, resulting in a sense of self-doubt as well. So I do feel it will be a mix. They will be picking up faster if it's their own language, will be able to communicate using that one language, learning across. Advantage may be there, but one cannot take away the element that mental health concerns will not be generated because of it. Because, the sudden change, the distress, the difficulty in the picking up that will happen when suddenly it's introduced, the loss of time, as it was not a language that was introduced in my early developmental years. And hence the disadvantage will also be there. So in terms of skills, in terms of future, when you take the global picture into context. So yeah.
Right. So this point is obviously going to get politicized, because politicians anyway looking for an opportunity to, recommend the medium of instruction to be in the regional language. Now, from a parent perspective, Shantanu, if you would like to comment on how would you feel if let's say your child is made to study only in the regional language up to a certain standard and, then move on to English. So what is your take on that?
Yeah, Sid, what I feel is this: in today's global era, we are always on the move. For example, a person will not be sticking around to his hometown or his home place for long. For work or for other purposes, he will certainly be moving out. Now, if he is transferred from one place to the other, and the kid has to again start his education in a totally new language, which he has not learned the ABC of also, it would really be difficult from the kid's perspective, first of all. Secondly, if you are studying, let's say, up to grade 5 in this particular regional language or mother tongue, it might also impact his English learning skills to some extent, which Vasundhara rightly mentioned that at a later stage, globally, English is the spoken language. And if that particular language is not has a good foundation in the initial years, I do feel it will be a challenge in the coming years as the kid grows. And thirdly, what I feel is that communication will also have an impact, because since the kid will not be well versed with the language what he is learning, he might be a bit confused in communicating with his peers or with the teachers, and that might impact his learning to some extent. That's what I feel.
I think the first part, the practical problem that comes across everybody's mind, I think even I had the same thought. So we cannot move out of the city, we cannot go to any other state. So, you know, there's a practical problem. The child cannot learn in a different language suddenly from the next class. So, yeah, so I think that's a very valid point. And even the ability to transition into English later on, as both of you said, Vasundhara and Shantanu, I think very valid points. Asha, would you like to take over? You're on mute.
Yeah, just continuing on the same point, I was just wondering how it would also impact, because the NEP on the one hand talks about inviting foreign institutions to collaborate in India. So how would this actually be perceived by them is something that's that I was thinking about. Any thoughts? Mridula?
Asha?
Yeah, go ahead.
So I would like to add a point here, not exactly about the foreign university, but to the first part of the question about mother tongue usage. NEP has not made it mandatory in the policy. It has clearly stated that wherever possible, and the states, they have their own, it is as it is in the concurrent list, still the states have a choice. So when it is a national policy, the policy is addressing the remote villages and the rural background people and the tribal communities. However, research says that, as Mridula also mentioned, mother tongue gives a concept clarity. So when the concept clarity is there, then the expressing content and communication comes into the picture. So policy doesn't mention that it has to be compulsory. It is suggested till grade 5, but still it is not mandatory, and wherever possible, bilingual could be used. And based on the implementation aspect, actually the schools or the governments can take a decision. However, coming to the mother tongue usage, definitely it has an added advantage, because it widens the horizons of children in interior places of the country. So policies are not just meant for the city aspects. When it is not mandatory, I think it is a welcoming change in the context of majority of the public school system in India, because 52% of the public schools in India are government schools and interior, where 14.1 crore students are studying. However, all the points mentioned by the other two panelists are 100%, I completely agree. Still, there are, in Indian history, there are many great people who were successful having their education in mother tongue, taking over language also. So language is something which could be, you know, equipped over a period of time. Thank you. This is my opinion, to make it very clear about it is not mandatory as per the policy.
Thank you. Thanks for the clarification, Jyoti. Manas?
So, I think ma'am rightly said that the key word in the policy is wherever possible. I think that itself justifies it. And the flexibility has been given to the state and the center and everyone else to collaborate on this. But I want to call this out, because in this next 1 hour or half an hour, we are going to discuss a lot of... can we have that sound? I think it's a very disturbing sound. Someone is, you know... Yeah. Okay, anyways. So you know, the point I'm trying to make is that...
Rick, sorry to interrupt. Can everybody keep the mics on mute when the other panelists are talking?
I think there is some TV noise or some other noise in the background.
The audience is on mute anyway. I think...
I think there's one person not on mute. Yeah,
that's okay. So before we discuss because I saw the set of questions, I think one point I want to make, and this is based on whatever readings I have been doing on this subject, NEP has to be understood as a policy rather than who made the policy, which government made the policy. I think if we look at, and you know, I was also seeing in the question, there was a point written that how much do you rate the current NEP policy, you know, and not regarding the, disregarding the implementation part, just as a policy content, is it good or bad? I personally feel it is around 9. And that is because the policy is damn good, as simple as that. But obviously, there is an implementation element to it, which needs to be discussed. And that is where the Herculean tax comes in. And, you know, the answer to the first question, obviously, is that the keyword is wherever possible. There is a huge uproar on that. It's more politics rather than anything else, to be very honest. It is clearly written wherever possible and bilingual. And English is a global language. I think today or tomorrow, everyone has to embrace it. As simple as that. So that's what is my point. Thank you.
Also, aspirationally, I think a lot of parents would want to send their children to English schools going forward, isn't it?
Yeah, so I think
including villages.
Right.
I think from a early education perspective as well, as Vasundhara very rightly said, there are certain benefits to learning in your mother tongue in terms of your technical skills. Communication is still a huge challenge. And in fact, I think this policy, the thought process is a little more for rural or semi-urban. We are not even talking about children who can, who have English as a listening area at home. We're not talking about children who have the exposure to English at home. We're talking about children who do not have English exposure at home, and hence school becomes the only medium for them to, or forum for them to learn English. And again, it's about the future. When we talk about European nations, a lot of them do have you know, languages that are very specific to them, which means they do produce excellent maybe engineers or designers, because in that kind of forum, language doesn't become very important. So it's very important to know what are we gearing our children for. If we are going to go forward and be very local and say, we're going to invest into industry here, we're going to invest into manufacturing here, this is all we want you to do, then it's okay to have your local language. You know, English can just be an add-on. This is for the rural or the semi-rural areas we're talking about. But if you want these children have aspirations to come out, to go to the city, to get a job which requires servicing and which requires English, then it doesn't make sense, in fact, more for them than even maybe for the urban children, because that's going to, you know, lose out on a lot of opportunity to expand their horizons. And that will be the greatest challenge. But I think the bigger challenge is in a lot of schools which are not very elite, the biggest challenge is that teachers are unable to teach in English. And that's a bigger challenge than the child, because the child will learn as many languages as you show him. Mm-hmm. So if you show the child, you know, 5 different languages, or expose the child to 3 different languages, the child will learn. But the problem is, can the teacher teach? And what are we doing to overcome that challenge, rather than saying, let's just skip English altogether, which is not really the solution to the problem. The idea is to see how can we empower teachers to increase communication. Written and reading can still be done, but what about the spoken element, which will be the greatest challenge going forward?
So that, thank you for that, Mridula. So Manas was giving a very good rating for the NEP. We are talking just in terms of policy, not in terms of the implementation part at this point of time. So if you were to rate the NEP on a scale of 1 to 10, to what extent do you think it has actually addressed some of the problems of the current education system? Obviously, it's not a Bible, but it's just an opinion about what you feel about it. So maybe we can ask Shantanu this question from a parent's perspective.
Yeah, sure. I would certainly say that as when Sid started this program, and he mentioned that this has been much awaited policy, and in fact, all of us were looking forward to some drastic change. All the parents wanted that their children should grow up on par with the other countries' education system and this. So it is kind of a welcome from all of us. And certainly it is, one step ahead than what was existing as of now. So that is definitely a positive point. And that really makes, with all what Manas was explaining, we are not talking about implementation. If we are just talking about the policy per se, it is really something which we should look forward to and which we are looking forward to. So I certainly rate it between 7 to 8 somewhere, because it is really something which, if implemented properly, it and can take care of rural India as well as urban India, then we are really in good hands, actually.
Great. Rudula, you are rating on a scale of 1 to 10, probably in terms of the learning outcomes that's expected from the changes?
I would rate it as a 6.5, maybe somewhere around that. The reason being, the policy is great. It's well documented. It's fairly comprehensive. It's got a lot of coverage. But yeah, as I think as Dr. Kasturi Rangan has also mentioned in his forward, it's clearly a policy. It depends, the implementation is the source, and that's where the change really will come. It's like the Bhagavad Gita, well written, now totally open to interpretation by all of us. I think though it's been a very long wait, I would have expected a little more in terms of teacher accountability. I would have expected a little more in terms of the private players mentioned as raising the bar in this country, and it's not really, we know very clearly public education is not raising the bar, they're trying to catch up. They should have been the ones setting the bar for all the private players. I would have definitely liked to see an acknowledgement of that. While they very clearly mentioned that foundation and literacy and numeracy is lacking, and very good thought process in terms of activity-based learning or learning outcomes, they haven't really clearly defined learning outcomes. I would have liked to see a little more clarity on what is it that's expected, because that's where parents have a problem. How do I know if I'm sending my child to a good school? What's my expectation at every level, whether it's a 20,000 rupees fee structure or whether it's a 1 lakh rupee fee structure, doesn't matter. I need to have some clarity on what am I expecting in terms of outcomes and who's responsible for it. So if you take away the test and exam system also and don't have any accountability for what the child is learning, I think what I would have liked to see is who's the judiciary in this, who's the one who's going to be saying, yes, we have achieved our learning outcomes, and why did it not happen in the past? I would have liked to see a mention of why did it not work all these years, and hence these are the 3 steps that I'm taking to correct those. While there is learning outcome not produced, which is output, there's no really mention of what are the, why have the teachers not been able to deliver? Or why is the government not able to deliver good education where private players are able to deliver and at a phenomenally high cost? So we know public education is costing all taxpayers quite a bit of money. So at that cost, if you're not able to deliver education, then I haven't seen a mention of that in the policy.
So you're missing performance evaluation and accountability. Teachers accountability.
Yeah,
interesting points. Navneet, would you have some points to share on this?
You're on mute, Navneet.
I believe that there will be slight advantage, especially for the completely Hindi and regional languages speaking section of society, because the parents can't see that what exactly their students are reading, if the medium of instruction is completely English or their homework, etc. If the students aren't getting help from their parents, then it would be pretty difficult for them to cope up, say, from the beginning itself. So for establishing a base, I guess 10 plus 5, I believe that the regional language could be much beneficial for those sections of society.
Thank you, Navneet. Dr. Jyoti, your rating?
Ma'am, you're on mute.
Sorry. From the point of school education and also to some extent to the higher education, if we are not considering implementation part, definitely I will also rate 9. In terms of the documentation, the policy has given its objectives and the learning. So the emphasis never was on learning outcomes earlier.
this is the first policy where the emphasis is being laid on learning outcomes, and most of the district educational officers or the most of the educators, they were into a lot of regulatory activities rather than monitoring the academic outcomes and all that. So a lot of scope is there to measure and make the learning outcomes accountable from the school end. And coming to the point which is mentioned that the learning outcomes are not mentioned very clearly, it is very clearly stated that what are the objectives, what is the roadmap, and what is the vision is mentioned in the policy, and to make it applicable or to make it seen the reality, it is clearly mentioned that the policy has given the mandate for NCERT and its three agencies, NCERT and Ministry of Education and School Education, because they wanted to frame the national curricular and pedagogical framework for early childhood care and education and national curriculum framework for school education by 2021 based on the requirements of NEP. So this is the first step of policy which is passed in the parliament. Actually, along with the years, and almost like 7 or 8 new agencies are going to be constituted, including the teacher education institutions to design the teacher standards as per the expectations, and NCTE, which is National Council for Teacher Education, about the professional development of early childhood education. So a lot of agencies are to be constituted, and timelines are given to come out with the curriculum framework and all that. And the best part of NEP is the assessment is made it completely in a different atmosphere, in terms of assessments are for learning. Till now it is about assessments of learning.
Yeah.
So that is the beauty of NEP. So from this point, even the subject choice and the, so to sum up in one sentence, all the 9 key principles of NEP 2020 has made me really to rate 9, because whatever has to be achieved by the Sustainable Development Goal 4 as per the Global Sustainable Development Goal, because India has adopted goal number 4 in the right. SDGs. So it has to be achieved by 2030. Yep. So if it has to be achieved by equitable and inclusive education for all, what all is required is mentioned in the policy.
So accordingly, it's quite comprehensive. Thank you for that. Vasundhara, from a neurological perspective, we have all read about how the best part of a child's brain development is up to 5 years. So now this policy has actually made a change of early childhood education to start at age 3. How do you think this is going to impact the development of the child's brain? Is it actually going to make a significant impact?
See, there are two things to be understood there, okay? One thing, when the policy came initially, I remember this discussion that happened. So, you know, my guides and, you know, the colleagues of mine, most of them are married, they have their own kids, and that's how it goes. So there were a lot of things that came into the picture at that time. They definitely brought in, so as a policy, definitely brought in the gaps in the non-availability that was there, sidelining of the liberal arts that used to happen, or vocational courses, non-provision of the life skills, and the lack of choices and the monotony that was there for a very long period of time. So, you know, but the concern that currently remains is that will it result in more confusion?
Sorry to interrupt you, Vasundhara. Yeah. For now, I was just thinking the impact up to age 5. Does this policy have any significant changes that will impact the child in an early childhood education stage, is what I was trying to find out.
Okay. From an early education or early developmental stage, the things to be understood is that I like that statement, that 1.2 pointer that has been made, you know, very clearly, which says about flexible, multifaceted, yes. You need to have inquiry-based, contextual, creative learning, and you know, thinking, all those
conceptual learning, experiential learning.
So all of those elements that they have put, they have used those terms really well. But yes, if it is put in the right manner, you know, when we were in child and adolescent psychiatry, these were the different things that we were actually taught. How to do art therapy, how to do play therapy, how to actually engage, how to actually break it down with children and do that. You know, if one modality doesn't work, then let's use a second modality. Let's use a third modality and all of that. And, you know, because you're trying to involve. So because inclusion was a major problem for a very long period of time. You know,
and you think that has been taken care now?
In the paper, if I say yes,
okay,
say yes, okay. Right. But I am very curious, or I would say as clinicians, we are very curious to know how this entire multidisciplinary team is going to actually play.
Right. So maybe in the next rounds of the discussion, we'll throw up more insights on that. For now, over to you, Sid.
Yeah, I think most of you have rated that the policy is very good and you've given good ratings for this policy. There is one recommendation in the policy which says children should start learning coding from grade 6 onwards or so, and artificial intelligence and coding skills to be given. So I'm sure Vedantu Super Kids would be very excited to know this, and even White Hat Junior, good business opportunity. From an implementation, finally we have to discuss implementation, and also whether it is feasible for kids to be forced to do this coding right from class 5 or class 6 onwards. So Mradula, would you like to throw some light on one end, whether it is feasible for a child to pick up coding at that age? Is it required to push children into this? Second, the vast majority of schools do not even have basic facilities, and we are talking about training them on all these skills.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're completely lacking on the infrastructure front as far as computers, computer labs, etc. I mean, there's a massive dearth of it. So again, this would give an unfair advantage to schools in a sense, if it is an advantage. That's debatable by itself. I'm certainly questioning why only coding. I mean, why not also carpentry, or why not have more options? Why does everybody have to become a coder? I mean, there are going to be children who have innumerable other skills, whether it's sports or whether it's music. Then shouldn't coding be one of those options? That there are going to be children who are intellectually inclined, there are going to be children who are physically inclined or artistically inclined. And if your policy is mentioning, you have mentioned liberal arts, you are mentioning diversity and so on, then I don't see why coding should be made as a mandatory. Of course, optionally, of course, it's a great option to have. And certainly we want to produce a large number of coders as well. And if that's the aspiration value, I think the market will take to it. But I don't think that should be the only option available to parents or to the child for that matter. Saying only if you become a good coder, you're going to be a smart child is a very, very, not a good reference point to have.
Great. So I think the liberal arts part of higher education changes, but it is not recommended at the school level. So that is where I think the point is. We are missing the point, saying that we are trying to push children into coding in class 5. And then we, and at the higher education level, they have got multitude of options to pick up from. So Shantanu, as a parent, what do you think? Would you like to push your child into coding?
Yeah, this is very interesting point, actually. From a parent's viewpoint, supposing somebody comes and says to you that if you'll keep your kid into coding, he'll be the next Bill Gates, or he'll be another kind of, Jeff Bezos. So then you will be really jumping around that, wow, this is such a good option. And secondly, it is as if nothing else is right now remaining in the world except coding. So from this angle, I would like to say, no doubt that we are moving, as far as technology is concerned, we are moving at a very fast pace. And it is absolutely necessary that each one of us, irrespective of the age, whether it's a kid or an adult, to adhere to these technologies and get yourself updated. For example, with these online sessions, you might have encountered that children, they are more educated how to handle a Zoom conversation than the adults actually. That how to switch on, how to switch off, how to record, they know much more. But now when it comes to coding, especially forget about grade 6, the companies right now are pushing the parents even for a 5-year-old or a 6-year-old that you should start the coding at this stage so that he nurtures his mind, he goes ahead and becomes a big genius out there as he grows actually. Now to share with you on a personal basis, my wife, she has been teaching coding for almost past 3 years now. And what she has observed that the parents are really so curious to get their kids into coding as if they'll miss the bus if they are not into this coding angle or whatever is being taught. So even if they do not have the means, they would still try somehow that they are on par with other kids. It's more of also peer pressure. Oh, my friend's kid, he has already started coding, so let me also enroll him into coding, whether the kid is interested or not, whether he has the time or not. So now what is happening is that 5 hours of classroom session, now the schools are online, plus then you put him into coding, plus his movies and games. So out of the 8 hours during the day, maybe 6 or 6+ hours are on screen in some way or the other. So we have to take a holistic point of view that how much firstly will it be helpful and how much will it really impact for the goodness of the child. This is what I feel as a parent as we move forward.
So earlier, I think it was more of JEE preparation. So this JEE preparation is getting eroded, I think, with the coding coming into picture. Working more on, I think, fear factor. Trying to instill fear in parents. Right, Manas, you wanted to add something?
Yes. I'm very eager to add some points here. And sure. You would have seen my hand raised 3 times. So it's one of my favorite subjects also. See, first of all, I would give my opinion both to and against, for and against. First, on coding. See, the entire word coding is misunderstood. Coding always does not mean just, you know, a language and you said, there is an element of a language, but there is also a very big element of logical reasoning. So basically, what does a code do? It basically tries to resolve a problem or tries to reach an outcome. And you think logically how that happens. And then obviously with your understanding of the computer language, you then code it. So if you remove the second part, which is more on the language. So language could be C++ or ABC or DEF or whatever. I think more important it is that logical reasoning as a skill should be there with kids. And that always does not require a computer. That is the point I want to make. And in my own jobs also, I have many times met people who you know, lack this very basic concept of logical reasoning, or in other word, in a very simpler way, basic common sense. You know, and more often than not, most of the business problems in the world are resolved by this beautiful word called common sense. So coding is not just about a language, but more importantly about the logical reasoning. Now, against this topic, I think I used to play a lot of sports when I was young. And I personally feel, I might be wrong, and it's an eminent panel, they can obviously add value to it. But I personally feel that any day going out, playing a competitive sport, not always for winning, but also to, you know, just enjoy the sport and, you know, teaches you much more than you can learn in front of a computer or for that matter, any other language. So, you know, whether it is teamwork, whether it is the spirit of winning, and more importantly, you know, because there is a discussion on local languages and not only English and all. So, you know, so as simple as that. I think it's good. It's damn good. I mean, you should go out, you should play. We should focus on students to go out and play and take part in other activities. And these are both my views on both the sides of the coin. Thank you.
I think fantastic point. I was just reading an article on this subject yesterday, which says, you know, focus on building fundamentals of children in mathematics and logical reasoning rather than running after teaching them coding skills in grade 1 or grade 2. Navneet, you want to say something?
Well, coding, machine learning, etc. These terms are pretty fascinating when we hear for the first time, like, wow, he's doing coding. is a kind of a machine learning is implementing different models and so-called artificial intelligence. But what most people feel that it's not the language by which they are doing such wonders. It's the basic common sense, you can say, or say, it's complex mathematics, rather say differential calculus or that, which is behind those. Being a coder myself, what I believe that given some, if someone has a common sense as well as the proper mathematical ability, then he can learn a language and implement the code within a week or say 2 weeks. That's more than enough for anyone to learn a language given he has some programming experience in any one of the languages. And I have seen my batchmates who didn't even coding before class 12, and they came to IIT Bombay and learned coding for the first time. Like they wrote their first code, and in just a 4 years time, they're like pretty big coders, or they're publishing research papers also in the field of machine learning and artificial intelligence. So I believe that
valid point.
Instead of learning coding from class 6, and as you know that children of age of 6 are learning coding, and parents are also pressurizing them, or say they are motivating them to learn just because of fear of missing out. It is going to do harm, as they would be more inclined just towards coding, and they would be thinking that fine, what exactly what we are doing, that's gonna we are going to do for the whole life. It is not true, right?
And just to add on a lighter note, the hero of the nation, Sonu Sood's son, is also doing coding. Huh? So should you, and so should all our kids. Just to add on the lighter note.
One more.
I forgot Shikhar Dhawan also. Sorry. I'm just waiting for some famous people.
A lot of Bollywood is doing that. Coding. To tell you the inside details. One important point is, as a parent, when you think that you really want good teachers for your kids, now where are those teachers right now? Are they trained? No, because the new education policy again says that for a new teacher, 4 years BEd program would be a mandate to become a teacher in a particular subject. So right now, any Tom, Dick and Harry can become a coding teacher. And this is, I'm telling you from my inside experience, what I learn is that they hire people and then the teachers themselves are taught like students. And then they're thrown to the online system that, okay, now you teach the students because we have enrolled these many kids. This is what is happening right now, the internal of these organizations.
You know, this is one of the reasons why private players are coming into them. Like you can see that White Hat Junior or many YouTubers, etc. Because one who has already done a program for computer science or coding for 4 years, he is not going to do again a period of 4 years, right? So the people who could actually teach coding and come into this profession, and rather than people who are doing BEd are then again doing a course of coding and then coming. And I don't think sure. They would be much interested also in coding as they enter the graduation in that.
So we'll come to that point of 4 year BEd a little later. So before we move there, Vasundhara, I just wanted one input from you. Shantanu just mentioned about the child spending 4 to 6 hours daily screen time, right? So first in the morning, online classes followed by coding classes. And, you know, there were also football classes being taught online, if you are aware, during the lockdown. Okay. So how does this impact the child's growth? Obviously the brain growth and ability to learn in future.
You know, there is a famous saying, if I don't know if all of you have heard it, but it goes like this: babies need humans, not screens. And I think that one statement speaks a lot. When I hear all of you saying of things and, you know, the amount of time people are spending, everything is on online, you know, small to the biggest thing. Even now we are speaking online, so everything is just on the online platform. I give sessions on online platforms right now, so sometimes it's telephonic, etc. When I speak of all this, the everything is good when it is within the limit, you know, when it goes beyond, be it anything. I think the learning theories or be it years and years of people who are in teaching, they have clearly mentioned about that. But more than anything right now, when I'm listening to all of you, my concern comes of, yes, we have all this coding AI, which was being brought in and which is nice. Yes, it works fine. But my question still remains, I would say rather my concern remains about the governmental versus the non-governmental schools. We are seeing in right now when I see people in the government schools, because, you know, I see people from there as well as I see people from the private schools, right? So when I see there is a government school in the picture where they are finding it difficult currently, basic amenities are not there. I was recently speaking to some of the Teach for India fellows who were saying that, you know, they are finding it difficult to pay the fees. So children are actually not coming in, or sometimes, you know, laptops or those basic smartphones are not there. So they are not able to do anything. So do we have those enough number of, say, trained, passionate teachers, or say, for example, a smartphone or laptop is there? Most of the times it is the elder one or the smarter child as per, you know, their parent thinks. They get it. So sometimes it is the food or other logistic concern that comes in, which prohibits a child to just go to the school. For a private school, the picture is completely different. So a couple of things that I strongly feel that may help is that we have CSR, which works in the country, which is a, you know, given policy for a very long period of time. You want to give the amenities, nobody's stopping you for that. But then I think the basic thing that CSR companies have to start is that I invest in something, I should also take on the onus of going back and checking that the money and the things that I gave or invested, what has it been used for? If teachers are having the difficulty, let them raise the voice. Let a training of trainers happen in a very structured manner. We have done that for a lot of period of time. It is approved. It is not now in the current scenario, in the current pandemic, it has been clearly proven that you can give anything online. So why not do that? And if passion is the concern, why can't you actually have, along with those teachers, have those fellows and the mentors or the students, inculcate in them the drive for passion and for teaching itself? Let the internal motivation work there. Why can't we work on that parameter? That's what I strongly believe in right now.
Valid point. I think you made a good point about infrastructure and untrained or semi-trained teachers. That takes us to another point. I would say alag alag logon ke alag alag samasya. So now the national policy also recommends activity-based learning, experiential learning in schools, in early education especially. Mridula, maybe you're the right person to answer this about early education. In the urban areas, we see parents very happy to have digital devices given to kids as against activity-based learning. And whereas when you go to rural areas, they don't have access to both, neither to activity-based learning nor to digital devices. So what is your take on this?
So, very clearly, I mean, the entire country and I think the entire world agrees activity-based learning is the best form of learning for young children. There's absolutely no doubt or question mark in terms of play-based learning has the best learning outcomes. There are some learning outcomes also very clearly defined in terms of we should have foundational literacy or numeracy. So the goals are clear. Now, how are we going to get there? As you just rightly said, activity-based learning itself is not very clearly defined. We know the best of teachers in very urban areas, in very elite schools, struggle with activity-based learning. We've been working with preschools with 1,200 preschools. I know 1,000 of them struggle to implement activity-based learning. Even after repeated training, most of the materials in majority of the schools are kept in the cupboard only to be brought out occasionally twice a year to show the parents. That's the sad state of affairs, and it's challenging. So training in terms of activity-based learning itself needs to be incorporated very clearly. When you say teacher training, extending the course and doing more theory on B.Ed. will not really help the teacher. We know they want to do it, but they don't know how. So the how needs to be very clearly defined to the teacher. And I think I'll come back to my point on the teacher accountability. The teachers sometimes want to do good, but they don't know what they're working towards. They don't know what their end goal is. They have syllabus completion as one end goal, which is okay, but that's not sufficient. There has to be a lot more than that on the teacher accountability front. I would still, again, go back to saying, I mean, the government is making a lovely policy. It's here to make, it is here as the legislature, as a policy-making body. I think the executive is very, very, is far superior on the private space than it is in the public space. This is a social sector. Education is one of the most key things that we are going to give our children. That's all we have to give our future children, to give our future generation. All we can do is equip them with the right skills. And I think if the private players are doing a great job of it at a much lower cost, it's it's the cost that the government needs to keep track of. So if the government can clearly define policies and say, I'm going to be the watchman that's going to watch you and make sure these are the learning outcomes, and this is the person who's going to come and check if you're doing the right thing. If the government moves out of the execution, I think the government will have a far stronger role to play in rewarding the right schools. And why not just give 20,000 rupees per child across the country to every child, irrespective of whatever economic status or anything. Then let the market decide which school you want to do. You want to send your child to a 1 lakh rupees school? You want to send your child to a 20,000 rupees school? There will be, the market will flourish, because then every school will be vying to be the best school and the chosen school. Coming back to activity-based learning, it's not very difficult. It's not rocket science. It's very simple in terms of play-based learning. But it needs structure. That's what's lacking in most places. And I find the policies good, but it needs to put a little more structure in place, saying for 1 hour, this is the kind of activities that you need to be doing. These are the kind of TLMs that you need to be using, which I think will come going forward in terms of implementation. I'm sure either they'll end up defining it or the players will end up defining what activity-based learning really means. I think the Andhra or Telangana government, one of them actually experimented with making Montessori compulsory in some ways. So different state governments have tried doing it. I know Chennai Corporation Schools have implemented Montessori beautifully, but then it was done entirely by a private organization. It was funded by that. So if it's going to come back to the private players, keep the cost affordable, keep caps and limits on that, and let the market decide. I think the market is really smart. Every parent knows, in a sense, this is a good school, not a good school. So if the government can support private education a little more, I think activity-based learning will be a super hit.
I think valid point you made regarding government becoming a regulator rather than running schools. I think we are still yet to come out of our socialist mindset where government wants to run airlines and they want to run schools and they want to run everything under the sun. Manas and Dr. Jyoti, maybe from an implementation perspective, since you operate schools mainly in urban areas, if you move to purely activity-based learning, would there be an acceptance or resistance from parents who are more inclined towards digital devices and modern technologies? So what is your take?
Mr. Sid, actually, this is not a new thing which has to be started. Not just the elite schools, most of the private schools and even in some of the government schools, this is there. However, early childhood education was not a part of the school education system. It was completely a separate thing. Now in NEP, they have added early childhood education as a foundational program right from 3 years age. Actually, unfortunately, most of the educators also do not know that under HRD and child and women development, there is a detailed early childhood care and education framework in which month-wise developmental activities, the framework, the examples with household items to be used, what is the learning outcome, how do the physical motor and gross motor, finer motor, cognitive development takes place, with what activity, everything is mentioned. So wherever there is a passion and accountability is there in the leaders or the managements or the private and both government schools, if the teacher is there or the headmaster is accountable, somewhere it's not happening. I cannot be controversial stating that most of the private schools are doing good, there is nothing happening in government school, but it is just lack of the implementation part and the passion and the accountability. As Murdula said, accountability is not stated everywhere. So if the person or the leader is passionate, it is happening. Activity-based learning, experiential learning is already there in most of the schools. It has its beautiful advantage. And to add on to that, even in NEP, the some words which caught my attention is public and private partnership, school complexes, and using, even for example, even if I have to take the coding, if it is mandatory, it is not exactly made it as mandatory, but there are open sources. Even for the open sources which are made by TCS, we have CS Patashala, which is open source for coding curriculum, computational thinking and the coding curriculum. We have CS First Google coding curriculum and code.org. There are 6 or 7 open sources which are free for coding curriculum also. Just I am giving an example. So the school complexes concept, if it is implemented, definitely the problem of this partnership resources could be addressed to some extent.
Sure. Thank you.
And activity based is nothing like rocket science, as Mrudula mentioned, because it's all with just using household items as per the psychological development, depending upon the age, and everything is clearly mentioned. And most of the teachers and educators, if they are well versed with early childhood education, they do know. So there the Anganwadis and the early childhood teacher training comes into the picture, which was not in the scene at all previously, earlier. Now it has to be strengthened or structured.
Right. So Manas, what are your views? Parents would accept this against the digital modes in urban areas specifically?
Let me understand the question a little carefully, because after Jyoti ma'am's answer, I'm totally confused. So are you saying, can you just please clarify your question again?
Yeah. So as per the policy, there's a recommendation that early education has to focus on play-based or activity-based learning, right? Okay. But in urban areas, parents tend to have a preference for digital methods rather than the conventional methods. So do you think this is possible to implement in an urban setup, especially in elite schools such as yours, compared to maybe other areas?
I'll answer that and confuse you further with one more additional answer. So first of all, answer is of course yes. Nothing is impossible, and is absolutely possible. And as Mrudula rightly said, it's not rocket science. So this entire word of experiential learning itself, I'm a reasonably educated man, but I myself took some time to understand it. But once I understood it and I went deeper into it, and Jyoti ma'am was one of the person who made me understand that long time back, and I actually understood it's very simple. It is just that it is told in a very big way, saying experiential learning and all. As simple as, theek se samjhana hai, activity based, bachche ko samjhana hai, as simple as that. It's not that difficult to understand. But answering your question, like, what Steve Jobs some time back said when he was alive, that customers don't know what they want. It is you who actually tell what customers want. So, parents can ask so many things. We have to give what we as educationists feel is a good mix. So activity learning, why not? Absolutely. And ideally, to give a more diplomatic answer, it should be a combination of activity based as well as digital and, whatnot. But let me tell you the question which I wanted to answer, which you didn't ask me. That's why I said I will confuse you. What about government schools? We are not talking about private schools. Private schools have the ability to go for any of the mode. What about the government schools? I think NEP, and that's where, while I rated 9 on the content of NEP, I would rate perhaps 2 or 1.5 on because of the humongous implementation that awaits this beautiful policy. Because now let's take it very simply. Think about a village. I don't know how many of you have gone to Anganwadi. I have in my career, and I have seen these areas. It is impossible. Let me tell you very simply. The very reason that they don't have a Dr. Jyoti or a Mrudula or or a Asha or a Vasundhara to manage those places. Let's be very frank about it. So the people who manage them, they themselves are not trained. So, and you expect them to give experiential training and learning and all that is too big a bite to chew, I feel. I think the good point is that government has now focused on that segment, early child segment, which was not there earlier. And our focus started from much after, which is good. But I think rather than discussing activity-based or experiential or God knows what, let us first just make it very simple ki 3 saal ka bachcha aake गांव में पढ़ सके और हैप्पीली पढ़ सके और कुछ तो भी खुशी से दिस इज माय लोकल लैंग्वेज स्पीकिंग ना बिकॉज ऑफ एनईपी सो द 3-year-old किड शुड बी एबल टू जस्ट स्टडी वेल दैट इज वेयर इट स्टार्ट्स बिकॉज यू विल बी अमेज्ड टू नो that Anganwadi and Balwadis are disastrously getting managed. Disastrously. If you see the bathrooms, the washrooms, the situation there is disaster. And with no offense to any government, I think it is a humongous task just because of your first line that, you know, India itself is a very big and densely populated country. I think the focus should be there. Focus should be on changing the attitude of how we can run a school smartly and how why a Manas or a Dr. Jyoti or a Mridula would work in that segment and take it forward rather than someone else who maybe not are the right person to take it forward. I think government should focus on privatization. Otherwise, we'll run Air India. We will never reach to Indigo level. That's what I would say.
Great. So you're saying basically in urban areas, there's no challenge, whether it is activity based, you can still make the parents accept activity based vis-a-vis digital.
Exactly.
Of course. Absolutely.
Yeah, Vasundhara. You want to say something?
Adding on to what Manasa said, yes, I totally endorse of what the socially disadvantaged population is having, and I also share my statement on the same. I totally second him on that. But for the socially advantaged, I feel in the current scenario, they have been deprived of the human contact. They are more or less left on their own. As much as we like the digital world, there is a fine line beyond which it hampers one's growth. You know, there is a famous still experiment, it's called, it's one of the best example of all the time. UNICEF has time and again said that you show them screens for a longer period of time, it'll hijack your attention span, it'll curtail your ability to control the impulses and empathy, it reduces it completely. Brain scientists have said that, you know, you need to have off-screen time as well. And that is the sole base towards your learning, social, cognitive skills itself to get better. And in simple terms, everything which can be introduced for the socially advantaged or the socially disadvantaged population, it has to be in the appropriate format. You talk about like SDG4, then it has to be happening in the equal manners itself. If at an appropriate time things are being done, then definitely limits have to be set. You know, limits, if they are not set in the form of providing for one section and limiting for the other section, then you will have another set of issues. There will be issues of social anxiety, distress, etc. All of them will come in. So you will see more difficulties and help coming in. And that will just hamper the brain and the personality growth because the balance gets disrupted. And that will completely affect the development, I feel.
Fantastic point. Asha, you're on mute.
Thank you, Sid. I think there's one point that Vasundhara, Mridula and Manas were all converging. We were talking a lot about the teacher's accountability and the teacher training aspects. So how do we attract brilliant teachers to be teaching people at government schools? Because teaching is not a very, it's not perceived as an aspirational course. There are many who do it. It's a very noble profession. I have a lot of respect for it, but unfortunately, not many people choose that as a first choice. And that being the case, how do we make sure that all of these get converted into reality? There's one clause in the NEP which talks about a four-year integrated BEED course for teachers. Would that make any difference in the way teaching profession is going to be perceived, or is there something more that needs to be done to make sure that there are enough teachers to be able to make themselves credible to offer all of these conceptual training, experiential training, and the liberal arts, whatever. I think there's something that that more that needs to be done to make sure that it's a preferred profession, right? Obviously, the salaries is one part that needs to be taken care. I think a lot of attention needs to be given to that. But apart from that, is there anything else that can be done? We can start with Jyoti.
First of all, government teachers, if the scales are given, if the government scales are implemented across the country, see, the teacher salaries are not an issue in every place. If the seventh pay commission salaries are paid to the teachers and the head of the schools across the country, irrespective of private or government, to some extent it's fine. Unfortunately, that is vice versa. Most of the places it is not implemented. And government teacher salaries, it is fairly enough to start with. Unfortunately, what I feel is the accountability of teachers. It would be surprising to know that, with due respect to this lady, Ms. Sangeeta Kashyap, 23 years she was absent from 24 years of her career. She is a government teacher. This is the fact. Government teacher, 23 years she was absent from 24 years. So most of the government places and the government shows funds, but execution is, accountability is zero. DEO only is very, very particular about clearances. For example, to start a private school or any school, to start with, we have to clear the 34 clearances. Until the time school gets executed, it is 100 clearances a school should get. So the regulation, the regulatory body and the professional development body, the accountability of checking the learning outcome and the execution, everything is one. So the entire focus is on regulation rather than monitoring the implementation of the education system or the curriculum. So to attract teachers, definitely. So even NEP has mentioned that housing allowances will be given, incentives will be given more. So what I feel is the passion has to be there. That has to be inculcated. Definitely wages, the salary perks will be implemented, perks will make a difference. And 4 years integrated course definitely will add a value if the quality is improved. Now, if with again due respect to the platform, any Tom, Dick and Harry, if they can get clearances, they can start a B.Ed. college. So if that system of multidisciplinary universities, no affiliation universities should exist, everything should come under one umbrella under higher education, all those things if implemented, and 4 years integrated education with quality B.Ed. curriculum as promised in NEP, if it is there, along with the professional salaries, perks as per the other corporates and everything, definitely. Or else if it is on the paper, we cannot do anything. Because a person without B.Ed. can do a wonderful job with than a person who is with B.Ed. if passion is there in teacher. I started my teaching career without B.Ed. As it became a mandatory, I did B.Ed. There are many young teachers with passion who can become the best teachers. In B.Ed. nothing is there. Though I am the educator, I did my B.Ed. I am telling. So the curriculum has to be revamped. The government should focus on what's happening in the school. Any other country does it accept if any government teacher is absent for 23 years out of her 24 years, and it became a nation's news in one of the newspapers at a point. Thank you.
Thank you, Jyoti. So quick views from Manas and Mridula on that point before we move on to sit for the next question.
I would like to give two examples. If anyone has seen the movie Bahubali, you know, the people who won the battle, even though soldiers were there who won the battle, it was Bahubali who actually gave the guidance and won the battle.
Exactly. So
the point I'm trying to make is you need to get the right administrators first. Just giving teachers blindly salary without any direction will not solve the problem. That's why I said you need good, talented people to work there. So that is point number one. Point number two is that if you take the example of, let's say, the Hyderabad airport, GMR build it, fantastic airport. Now, why was that type of airport not there, let's say, 10, 15, 20 years back? You have to give it to the private players. Government, again, tries to get into everything, which is good. Let's say 50, 60, 100 years back, but not now. Today is the era where you give it to a private player, you set the accountability, you set, and you know, that is how you try to win the game. Otherwise, we can discuss this, we and, you know, 10,000 people like us can discuss all this, but it can never get resolved. You have to give it to the private players. And finally, I want to give the third point, is that while education is a noble profession, you know, if you go to the West, which we try to ape a lot and we feel that they do everything so well, you know, the very reason, if you go to one of their government schools, you will be amazed you know, some of my you know, relatives and other people are studying and they're quite doing well. And they say government school बहुत बढ़िया है यार, हमारे private school से क्यों इतना पैसा देना, जो government से everything I'm getting, government school. So why do they get that? They get that because education is not treated as a non-profit making organization. If I'll be very honest, if I am a entrepreneur, I will not put money for charity. Then I will go and join Miss Mother Teresa or her organization with due respect. Let me make it very clear. People might hide behind, I don't like to make political statements. I am not going to put money if there is no profit coming in. Otherwise, why should I will do charity. So if the government realizes this and actually apes this point from the West, where education is privatized, it is no, I mean, you know, accountability is set. You will see the best of government schools, the best of Anganwadi, the best of Balwadis, and you will see our kids also going to such schools happily. Believe me on this. Otherwise, you know, we can keep discussing this. And, you know, that's how it is. Yeah.
Yeah, to add on to Manas' point, if, out of the world's top 10 economies, 8 of them allows schools for profit. So without return, sustenance and growth, if the institutions are not viable, there is no quality in education, whether it is in government or private. Definitely, it has to be viable to run the institution. So
I think that's the only answer for sustainability of credible institutions.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think I completely agree with Manas on that. I'm all for obviously privatization of education for even on a very large scale. I think the government should still maybe run a few model schools, or this is the way schools should be run, and restrict themselves to guidelines and policies. And you just cannot, in any system where you have the legislature and the executive mixed up, there's always going to be a challenge. In this case, the judiciary ends up being the parents, because the parents are the buyers into the system. And we clearly are seeing a shift from government to private schools. Parents do not want to send their children if there is an option. The problem is the option is not available. I think it would be great for the government to step in with teacher rewards to increase teacher motivation. I think teachers work extremely well with high motivation at micro level deliveries, where the team is small, where there are 10 people and everybody is, there is somebody to guide the teacher. Not one out of thousands of Anganwadis where nobody knows who that person is or what kind of work they're doing. There's neither appreciation nor punishment. There's nothing on either side. So, which means your motivation levels remain kind of stagnant for the adults. I think the most important element, in a sense, we are still missing is the judiciary. The NEP has mentioned civic society, has mentioned social workers, and so on. A large part of these civic societies, if we can harness them to measure learning and to evaluate learning and not have that. The private player will obviously say, I'm doing very well, my school has very good learning outcomes. But who's to decide that? Who's going to be the judge of whether learning outcomes are actually being produced? So if we can establish an independent judiciary, which can be composed of the NGOs, of civic society, of some wonderful organizations who are already doing it at micro levels, the government can definitely build a franchise sort of model in every village where somebody is actually taking accountability of that Anganwadi, and it's owned by somebody and not by the government. Government can give its policies, but it has to be a profit-making venture, as Manas absolutely rightly said. Then there is, the minute that comes in, there is always going to be accountability, and the profits need not at the village level. They won't even expect very large profits. People are willing to be dedicated teachers as long as they are getting recognition and reward, both money as well as recognition for it. That's all it takes to have the motivation. So if the government can play the regulatory role well in terms of policies, and we have an independent judiciary saying, yes, this guy has, you know, is maintaining hygiene, this person is taking care of safety and is producing learning outcomes, then we're home. We can then educate our 1.5 million children below the age of 6, our 4 million children below the, you know, below 14. That's the numbers we're talking about today.
Yeah. 2 points there. I think one is they have to survive to be able to take care of others, and two, the work involved in NEP is so humongous that there's no way I think the government can handle it all alone and derive the results at the end of the day. So the public-private partnership seems to be a non-debatable topic. Over to you, sir.
And accountability comes, Asha. Accountability comes if you set targets, if you set goals, you pay for pay as per that. In a mall, when you say, if you are happy with my service, do a green button and whatever, that is fine. But in a school, why can't we do that when parents come and press the same green or red button? And you keep make the private player accountable for that. Make the parent happy. That is how it should work.
Thank you. Sid?
Yeah. So one last point from my side. Is the NEP trying to become everything for everyone? Overambitious, wanting to do multiple things. Now look at higher education. They recommend decentralizing the university system and have non-affiliating universities. So right now we have got state universities and hundreds of colleges, which of course is not a great structure to be in. But now trying to shift that and making things autonomous, are we getting into a problem of the erstwhile IIPM kind of a controversy? Will we end up opening a Pandora box of problems? So anybody, I think this is an open question, anyone can answer.
It's very impressive on intention, Sid, but it is inadequate on implementation. In one word, in one phrase, I can say it's very impressive, but inadequate on implementation. How best it can happen, I'm really clueless.
So we should have started first with schooling and then moved to higher education, maybe. Yeah, Manas, yes, please.
No, I don't agree. I feel that to hope is the best thing that mankind can do. So it first starts with a hope or a plan or an aspiration. So from that perspective, I think the aspiration is quite good. One critical thing that we need to, and Sid, you would understand that because you were in this same thing, that you know why Indian universities rank so low in the world compared to the global universities. Why can't, I mean, what is that IIT doesn't have? We have a gentleman from, I think IIT, if I'm not mistaken, Mr. Navneet. And you know what is that IIT Mumbai or a Delhi or whatever doesn't have that some ABCD university in some other country has? So I mean,
So talking about the international rankings, basically there are various factors which depends on what exactly how the ranking is based. For example, the teacher faculty ratio or the infrastructure or can say number of foreign students or foreign faculties. So there are various number of things apart from just research and patent filing. There are different various things which are in the NIRF ranking. In the world ranking. So given IITs have a lesser number of, you can say, foreign faculties as well as a negligible number of foreign students, which results in basically low points in the rankings, and hence the ranking is bad. But coming towards, you can say, actual research, that's not really that bad as stated. So I guess the IITs are good enough to provide education for the students. And personally, I believe that the autonomous, since IITs are autonomous and it's up to the director or say the HODs to define the syllabus as well as the course curriculum. And I believe that that's pretty good for us, for students, because they take like students' opinions also. And I guess that's good.
Correct. But the point I was also trying to make is that, you know, if you see the foreign system, universities actually progress as either teaching universities or research-based universities. Mm. Yeah. In our case, we are everywhere, you know, God's gift to mankind. That's how we work, you know, and the problem, as rightly one of you said, is regulation. If the regulation is there and good thought process is there, then, and if you read the NEP carefully, it doesn't say that kal tak kar denge. It very clearly says that it will take some 10 years or 12 years and then whatever. I mean, you know, in phases it is going to be done and all. That's one. Second thing is, now I would also like to call out this entire thing of brain drain. Now, why is that, you know, when I was young, I mean, I'm still young, but when I was younger, when I was like a kid, you know, I wanted to go to US to study. You know, what was so great about US which was not there in India? I think that entire brain drain concept is also there because we think that, you know, compared to our university and IITs, at my time there were 6 IITs here. I was damn good a student, but I couldn't get through. Thankfully, I did decently well in my life. So, you know, now I understand there are some 15-20 IITs or God knows how many IITs.
20
but I wish IITs it was there. How much?
20
how
plus IITs or something. I guess 23.
Okay, fine. God bless them. But, you know, the point I'm trying to make is that, you know, if NEP, and if you read the draft carefully, NEP says that they will allow private universities from outside to build campuses in India. And that also helps because, you know, then I don't need to, I mean, just for Harvard, sake of a name, I'm saying Harvard, but it could be whatever. So, you know, let's say a Harvard campus in Delhi, why not, yeah? I mean, why will I go? And I save cost, you know. My father would be the happiest if he hears that, you know, people don't want to go outside and at one third of the cost, things can be done in India. So aspiration-wise, I think it's very good. But implementation-wise, we need to support. We need to support a vision like that. Again, the right people have to come in. But I think the vision is fantastic. It is possible to implement it. It is not impossible. In fact, it is not rocket science. I mean, I would say so. I have hope. I have hope of a Harvard campus in India or whatever, XYZ campus in India.
I think everyone loves rocket science here.
Also, as per the timelines also, Manas, it is at 2030, sprouts of this ABP will be seen. And by 2040, policy completely becomes operational. So now we are in 2020. I think for 20 years, if this is the vision, definitely it has to be implemented or seen. There are more advantages in the higher education system, whether it is about academic bank credit transfers or multiple choices. So many beautiful accommodations are given, whether it is Meru or whatever, multiple, only single university under multidisciplinary education and research university. More importance to research and all that. So it is beautiful. So by 2040 at least or 2030, if we can implement minimum 50% of it, definitely it will be good.
So no, again, I come to the same point. You hire a good regulator who will do the job for you and the same IAPM can cater. Where will you get universities? I was, you know, thanks to you, Sid, I was reading through some data and, you know, I came to know that if NEP has to be implemented, it seems one university has to be opened. A new university has to be opened every week. Then only it can cater to this thing. I mean, you know, without IIBM model, you can't get that. Let me tell you, with due respect to Mr. Chaudhary, whom I don't know personally. But, you know, so that is the only model. Franchisee is the only model to win over. But you need the right regulator. You can't say our babus will do that. Then it is God bless India. So there has to be a regulator, accountability. They get paid if they deliver. There is a fixed component, there is a variable component, and that is how it works, just like any other private organization. As simple as that. And then they will deliver the goods to you. I think there are enough people who can do the audit. Enough.
The demarcation should be very clear between funding, regulation, operations, and accreditation. All four should not be the same.
Shantanu, would you like to add something?
Shantanu, funding, Sundra. Operation, accreditation, and regulation. That's interesting. Manas, you were mentioning about the rankings at the international level. Do you think that the NEP is insisting on even premier institutes going multidisciplinary? Would that in some way help us with the rankings going forward?
I mean, they have very simply copied the foreign model. So, of course, if they follow that and they're able to get it, of course, our rankings will improve. But it is like the Oscars. I care a damn about what is my ranking in the world. If my guys are coming out and doing well, I mean, who cares what ranking they give in the, whether Harvard is better or Cambridge is better or whatever. It is just like the Oscar versus our fight in films, how it works. I mean, I think the more pertinent focus is not the ranking. The pertinent focus should be that can we build a system where our kids don't go out, but they actually are also given the right facility in India and they join good companies in India and do it. And while I'm a fan of Narendra Modi, I'm not a BJP guy. So I'm just telling from logic more than anything else.
Interesting. Yeah? Shantanu, I think you had some insights to share.
No, I was just listening to these points. Now, from a parent's perspective or from a student's perspective, for example, Navneet is here. Everybody is worried about a career. Means what exactly after all these years of education, will he get a particular job or one which is recognizable by the industry? At the end of it, everything comes to it. Now, what Manas was saying, that of course universities are coming. Harvard has already set up a campus here in Mumbai where they are giving a course, which of course is again very highly priced and for the elite, or maybe company sponsored, something like that. At the same time, we are having collaborations with the foreign institutes. Our rankings may not be so good. Although, for example, Indian School of Business, it has found a good ranking amongst the top management institutions of the world recently. So things are improving. But again, when we come at a point and with this new education policy saying that all vocational courses would also be there and commerce will be treated on par with science, will be treated on par with arts and this. So as of now, when things will be definitely clear as we move forward, but today there's a confusion in the minds of parents as well as students, especially those who are on the brink of, let's say, class 12 or class 10, that what exactly should they expect, where should they go, and from where should they get that guidance. That and same if you see the parents, they are running to counselors, means which is again a kind of a professional means help which is needed. And I agree to these educational institutions what they have mentioned, that yeah, you pay and you will get quality education. But if you see from a parent's perspective, and the point that in India you have varied social structure from poorest to the richest. For them, for riches, they can certainly afford high education. But imagine if you are providing this primary quality education, let's say 5 lakhs, 6 lakhs per annum, how many of them can afford it? Let's talk on a kind of a level where everybody, we want to improvise the rural people and educational institutes to be sustainable, they want the money to run. Now, how to get that gap bridged is, I feel, a challenge actually, because they are totally correct on their perspective. But at the same time, the society, the current rural or middle class, what you call in India, they have their own limitations. So I think that would be a challenge as we move forward.
Yeah, I think that's going to be the biggest implementation challenge. Closing remarks from, I think we are running out of time, so we need to wind up. Maybe we have a minute for each of the panelists to share closing remarks. Mridula?
Yeah, sure. So I think pretty much a lot of common thought across the panel in terms of moving towards privatization, accountability, and having a clear-cut structure. I think at the end of the day, we all need to look at education is the final outcome that we're looking at. So we can't be running X number of government, millions of lakhs of government schools just to provide employment to teachers. The final outcome is education. And that has to, you know, the focus needs to be on that and not about everything else. So any privatization or anything that we move towards, I think we need to keep our eyes focused on learning outcomes, how are we going to get there, and who's going to measure it. I think that's pretty much what I'd like to conclude with.
Jyoti?
Yeah, I feel the responsibility towards implementation with proper reasoning and resilience to face the challenges to make it a beautiful policy in terms of implementation, only make the change. So it's a welcoming change, but there are a lot of thoughts about the implementation aspects.
Manas?
So I spoke a lot, so yeah. I would just summarize by saying we should have more such debates and more such people who talk about these topics and give advice to government rather than having news on you know, who was taking drugs and who died and whether it was a suicide or not. I feel, to just summarize in a very simple way, we need to be serious about education, and NEP is good, but we need a eminent panel to across the country, different people come together, plan, execute, because all of us commonly agreed that execution is the one which is going to be the challenge. So that is what I think that is what we need to look at. That would, and I'm eternally hopeful that things will become much better. They're not bad, but they'll become much better.
Shantanu?
Yeah, we saw that all the stakeholders have their own perspectives. And what I feel that there should be a convergence and understanding of each other's issues or each other's side is very important and relevant. Because once you understand the other party's issues or problems, the implementations, things become more clearer. And I think it really has a then good atmosphere prevails. And what everybody has said, that implementation is the key. And we are looking forward to a smooth implementation over, let's say, next 10 years or 20 years. And we hope that we certainly reach what we are looking forward to.
Navneet? Can you unmute?
So I would again say that the implementation is one of the things which has to be taken care of, as there are different various policies. And I guess the earlier policy about education was also not that bad as the education system currently is. But for implementation, different steps have to be taken, like this policy framing won't work at any cost. And for that, again, accountability comes. But in the government space, basically, accountability is much more required. And in the private sector, rather, well, they can't say to exactly the fix the cost, because education systems have to take care of themselves also. But then also a regulation on cost should be done, so that they just don't inflate the price too much high, as Manasar told that the Harvard business schools are charging too much as they set up campus in Mumbai. And I personally believe that the foreign campuses, people would join for sure because of the brand name, but I really don't think that they would be again at par with our own country education system, such as IITs also, because again, a newly established institution can't provide that much exposure and that much teaching abilities compared to the older ones. So again, the implementation should be done well, apart from the policy training.
Coming as a mental health professional, I would stick on to saying on that, education ecosystem is one of the major subsystems in the entire, you know, growth. It has a major stake. We have spoken about nature versus nurture when we were growing up. Right now, it's more of the Brockenbrenner model that we say. And one of the major, you know, stakeholders of the microsystem itself is a school, where you're setting your base to the entire journey and the development that you have. I genuinely hope, from a mental well-being, there are a couple of things that the government definitely, and the NEP, I genuinely hope that those things come in, that we start speaking about mental health as it's a common topic altogether. It is not shushed down anymore. I genuinely hope the teachers, parents, and all the stakeholders who are there are educated. That multidisciplinary team that all of us have been time and again speaking about, let's have someone there who can cater to the needs. If teachers are finding it difficult, let the referrals happen. Let them know what is right and what is wrong. Where is the tipping point? And if we don't do it now, the current, you know, issues and COVID-19 pandemic that has clearly, you know, showed it to us what at max can happen, if we don't take care of it right now, no matter what policy you bring in, no matter what big acts or principles that you put in, no matter what manpower is, you will actually be not fulfilling the entire holistic approach that you actually want to do. That's all I would have to say.
Thank you all for joining in on this show and sharing very valuable insights. Thoroughly enjoyed it.